This is the last video in a series of 7 about an NEQ-6 belt modification. You might like to check the other ones out first. Right. Finally, we get to test that everything works and see that it goes around smoothly. The first test of a sort was to actually turn it on. Because I'd been mucking about with the controller board, I was a bit nervous that it'd even fire up, but it did. I didn't hear that satisfactory clunk that it used to make when it started, though. The second test was to see if it slewed at all and what it sounded like. I'd set the backlash screws, which I'll get to in a minute, in a fairly neutral position so they just kind of felt as though the gear was meshing. I didn't want it to set so hard that the gears would bind or the belts would slip straight away. Using the hand controller, I slewed both axes in both directions, so the thing went round several times. I wanted to do this to spread the new grease that I'd been putting in around, but I also wanted to just listen to the sound it makes, and oh my god, it's so quiet. When you stop and start, there's none of that grinding, rattling sound that it used to make, even from when I first got it. I'm not sure what it was exactly, but I think all NEQ-6s do it, but not now. It's as quiet as anything. I'll finish off with the video with the mount slewing, although I'm not sure the difference from what it was like will be really obvious on the video. The next thing to do was adjust the backlash. I'm no expert on this, and I'm not even sure that I've done a really good job, but I'll be checking the PhD2 logs to see how it looks. PhD also does an analysis of your backlash when it calibrates, so I'm keen to see that. I'm a bit nervous actually, as this is the first time I've ever actually adjusted the backlash on my own. With the NEQ-6, adjusting the backlash is a lengthy and pretty boring process, so I'll keep this to a minimum. Backlash is the physical gap between two gear wheels. You always need some, or the gears bind, you know, they get stuck and make horrible noises and wear each other out. But if you get too much, the gears don't reverse nicely. You have to wind one gear quite a long way before it even has any effect on the ones further down the train. The belts that we've just put in get rid of a lot of this, but there's still one pair of gears left. That's the worm shaft and the brass wheel on each axis. The way it's done is you can move the worm shaft and the brass worm wheel closer together or further apart. The worm housings, that's these guys, both have grub screws in either end, and they work against a lug on the inside of the main housing, that's that guy. As long as the M6 bolts aren't too tight, the grub screws move the worm housings up and down, and this adjusts the gap. Closer together, and you get less backlash, but more binding, and further apart, you get less binding, but more backlash. The strategy I used was to adjust to get less and less backlash until the gears bound. They made this horrible noise. Actually, I think it might have been the belt slipping over the aluminium gear on the motor shaft. I didn't get that on video because it's such a horrible noise, I didn't want to do it a second time for the camera. Once I got to that point, I backed it off a bit, about a sixth of a turn, and then tried again. It slewed smoothly all the way around, so I tightened up the M6 bolts and ran it around again to make sure it was okay. Now it's done, there's a tiny bit of play left, and you can see it when you move the axis by hand.
Well, this is a demonstration of what backlash is left. You can feel a bit of backlash when you move the RA backwards and forwards, and you can even hear it. I've put the microphone on there. We'll see if we can hear it. There's a slight clunk as you move it backwards and forwards, and you can feel a little bit of play there, so listen carefully. I don't know whether you'll hear that. It's even less in the declination, so I'll just do this. You can hardly feel the backlash there at all. Now, that's adjusted by these screws, the worm screws for the RA, this housing here. The worm screws are there and there, and they push the RA housing backwards and forwards like that, so which it means that the wheel gets closer to the grub. Same for the declination, obviously.
Okay, I put the microphone, you can probably hear it. The microphone's actually on the side of the mount, so hopefully you'll be able to hear a little bit more of it than me. So let's go and repeat the demonstration for sound. love that sound. That's so quiet. Okay, it's a couple of weeks later, and I've had a chance to do some testing. I went up to the dark sky site and took some test images. At one stage, I had to do some meatball surgery and adjust one of the worm gears after it bound during a slew. I can't remember which one. I didn't really enjoy that bit. The tracking is a bit better. It's down closer to one arc second now, RMS, but I'm still working on my PhD settings, so I'm hoping I can get it better than that. That's where we are, I think. We're done. The last thing I'd like to do is thank Rowan Astronomy for producing the product, Sidereal Trading for actually getting it to me, and Kari Brown for his series of videos. Finally, I'd like to thank my employer, Optics Central, for allowing me to make this video and put it up on their YouTube channel. It's probably not going to drive a lot of sales for them, but I think it shows their commitment to the hobby in general. So next is to continually adjust, and we'll see how the photographs start turning out. So clear skies to everybody.